Why the critical mass is not about the mass.
The concept of the critical mass in nuclear physics is knowing whether you have a stable configuration or an exponentially increasing power source.
Some scientists were hard at work in order to release the exponential power, while others were hard at work to try and stop it.
But today, I'll explore why the critical mass is a very vague concept.
I'm going to visualize this with the help of simulations that captures real physics. You'll be able to understand the important physics of nuclear power plants and atomic bombs. Nuclear fission and critical mass. First of all, what is the critical mass and why does the concept only kind of make sense? Let's understand induced fission with uranium-235 as an example. Here, on this table of nuclei, you can see all of the known nuclei. The color depicts if the nucleon is stable or what kind of decay it will undergo when left alone, black for stable. If we zoom in on uranium-235, you can see it has 92 protons and 143 neutrons. Going one step horizontally on the chart represents adding or removing a neutron, i.e. changing isotopes. Going one step vertically represents adding or removing a proton, i.e. changing elements. For nuclei above a certain size, above iron and nickel specifically, some and only some of them will have the ability of undergoing induced fission. Uranium-235 can undergo induced fission. When this fissile material is hit by a free neutron, the uranium becomes unstable and is split into two smaller daughter nuclei, krypton and barium, and also release three new secondary free neutrons, and of course, also releasing a great amount of energy. The isotopes in the reaction can be seen here. Uranium-235 releases a barium daughter nucleon and a krypton daughter nucleon, and of course, also three free neutrons. These neutrons can strike other uranium nuclei, multiplying exponentially and creating a nuclear chain reaction. This exponential power is crazy. One neutron becomes 3 neutrons, become 9 neutrons, become 27 neutrons, and so on. After 51 generation, you will have 2 million billion billion neutrons uranium interactions, or 1 kilogram of uranium would have been split. Enough to wipe out a big city. However, during the chain reaction, it's also possible for the neutrons just to escape the surface of the uranium chunk without hitting any new nuclei. You will therefore need a minimum amount of mass to get the chain reaction started, and this is the concept of the critical mass. If we assume a normal pressure, a spherical shape, and 100% purity of an isotope, we can calculate a theoretical critical mass, but there are many more factors than just the mass that comes into play, which we'll explore in this video. Building the simulation and understanding criticality. To better illustrate what is going on, I'll switch out this old representation of fission that we used before. And instead of showing fission like this, I will instead show the enriched uranium nucleon as just dark blue. You'll keep the neutron color dark gray as before. Upon induced fission, I'll change the color to light blue. Of course, in reality, this really represents two new daughter nuclei that should break apart. Just think of the nucleon as having potential to fission or not. Now, with this new syntax, we can try an experiment. Let's surround a neutron with lots of enriched uranium nuclei and see what happens. I think this simulation illustrates the tremendous power of a chain reaction. Instead of the term critical mass, we can use the so-called multiplication factor K. It tells us something about the critical state of the system. It is defined as the number of neutrons produced at time plus 1 divided by the number of neutrons produced previously. If K is equal to 1, it means for each neutron produced, that neutron will on average also produce another neutron, so we have constant power. An ideal scenario for a nuclear power plant, we call it critical. If K is below 1, it means for each neutron produced, on average it does not produce a new one, and so the reaction is dying out. We call it subcritical. Employees at Chernobyl desperately try to employ control rods and transition into this subcritical state. If K is above 1, it means each neutron produced produces even more neutrons. This is called supercritical, and we want to maximize that number in an atomic bomb. From the simulation before, I can calculate the K factor. X-axis is the time, and the y-axis we have the K value, therefore these are the critical regions. Let's go. First, the system is in a supercritical state, but it's never stable at K equals 1. Later, It is subcritical and the system dies out. Let's see what we can do to influence this criticality of the system, even without changing the total mass. Factors of criticality. Purity. So far in the simulation, we have assumed 100% pure uranium-235. This would be weapons-grade uranium. But when you extract uranium, only about 1% will be of the isotope uranium-235 and the rest will be a non-fissile uranium isotope. You must refine and enrich the material with expensive centrifuges before you can feasibly use it in a fission process. The presence of impurities such as non-fissile isotopes can absorb neutrons or simply decrease the chance of a neutron hitting a fissile nucleon. Here, you can see a failed attempt of chain reaction due to too low purity. For a power plant, low enriched uranium is used and only about 5% enrichment is needed for fuel for the power plant. The aim, of course, is to keep the criticality stable at around K equals 1. Let's see if we can do that in the simulation. First, I'll introduce two new features in the simulation. Let's add control rods, depicted as black rectangles. Control rods are made of elements with high neutrons capture property that does not decay themselves. Boron has this property. These rods can quickly stop an out of control chain reaction. Secondly, let's introduce the feature to magically enrich use of uranium. Let's use these two new features to run a nuclear chain reaction simulation and keep it enriched around 5% purity. I'll use control rods to limit the amount of neutrons to 40. When there are above 40 neutrons, we raise the control rods. It's actually very hard to keep the neutron density approximately constant, because as soon as we're tipping to either a subcritical or supercritical state, you'll have an exponential increasing or decreasing situation respectively. Shape. Another thing we can do to influence the criticality is the shape of the fissile mass. Depending on the geometry, the criticality is highly affected. For example, a thin cylinder is a terrible configuration for a chain reaction. The high surface area and low volume causes too many neutrons to diffuse out of the uranium chunk.
Atomic bombs normally use a sphere.
A sphere is the absolute best way to pack fissile material for supercriticality because it has the lowest surface area to volume ratio. Shape is what the atomic bomb little boy used to trigger the mechanism. Before firing, the shape is engineered such that two uranium chunks are separated and are subcritical. And a stray neutron in both chunks would quickly decay away, not causing a premature detonation. But after triggering, frying the two chunks of uranium together, the chunks' combined shape would be in a supercritical state and stray neutrons will set off an atomic blast. Density. I can put these nuclei more neatly packed, such as in the hexagonal structure. This is the absolute best way to pack circles as tightly as possible. Of course, this is just me playing around, showing the effect of density, pretending uranium nuclei are circles. This, of course, has nothing to do with actual real uranium. Let's try the simulation again with this hexagonal structure. You can see we had a much, much more violent supercritical state. This is exactly the principle of implosion bombs, such as the so-called gadget used in the Trinity test shown in the Oppenheimer movie. This device has the fissile core surrounded by TNT-like explosives. Before the explosion, the fissile core is subcritical, but after the explosion, the core is imploded, and the high density means that stray neutrons will release a supercritical chain reaction. This is especially a smart move in atomic bombs, since the nuclear chain reaction scattering fission fragments increases the pressure and destroys the core. This means, of course, decreasing the density. I can simulate that if I add this scattering property. Now, uranium on uranium collisions will transfer some momentum. The same will neutron on uranium collisions. Let's run a chain reaction again with this property. You can see the fissile clump disintegrates.
In the animation, some of the uranium nuclei weren't hit by a neutron and we had wasted potential.
If too much fissile materials goes to waste, you'll have a much, much lower yield. This failed explosion is called a fissile. You can see, if I use explosions like the gadget did,
I can crush the core via implosion and create a very high density region and also an inverse inertia force,
combating the nuclear scattering outwards pressure. Bonus tricks affecting the criticality. There are other tricks used in atomic bombs to bring down the minimum required mass and enhance the criticality. The first thing we can do is to use a neutron initiator.
It's a reaction that has the property to burst out a lot of neutrons.
Polonium and beryllium is an example of this. Secondly, we can use a strong shell around the fissile core called a tamper. This tamper tries to withhold the outgoing force just a tiny, tiny time scale to allow even more neutrons to undergo fission. If you can hold the core together just for another neutron generation, you can effectively double the yield. I'll add the tamper to the simulation depicted as a circle and allowing a few hits of uranium nuclei before it is destroyed. Finally, we can add a neutron reflector. This simply brings neutrons back into the system again. I'll do that in the simulation, painting this neutron reflector in yellow. An example material could be graphite. This would be a really smart move in atomic bombs, but hopefully nobody would ever put graphite tips on control rods. Putting all of these tricks together, get the gadget used in the Trinity tests, the first ever atomic explosion.
Now I am become death, the destroyer of worlds.
I tried my best to keep the simulation clear without too many distractions, but for clarity I did brush over cross-section absorption, the concept of fast and slow neutrons with moderation, secondary neutrons, secondary fission products and decay branches. But now you know that the term critical mass can be a bit misleading.
Hopefully, now we all agree that the critical mass depends on the mass and a whole lot of other factors.
Thank you for watching. In the outro here, I'm showing you very, very early ideas about the atomic bomb from the now declassified Los Alamos primer. A set of lectures given to new scientists arriving at the Manhattan Project.